In the name of Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, one true God. Amen. At the very outset, I would like to express my gratitude for this opportunity to make a brief presentation on the hymn of Severus of Antioch. Severus is an important figure in the history of the Church. He is honored in the Church as a defender of Orthodox Christology over against Chalcedonian Christology of two natures. We remember more Severus the Patriarch in the fifth duptena of our Holy Liturgy as follows. In quote, "The crown of the Syrian, the eloquent mouth, the pillar and doctor of the Holy Church of God as a whole, the meadow abounding in blossom, who preached all the time that Mary was undoubtedly the mother of God," unquote. These adjectives throw light in the significance of more Severus in our Church. Thus, he is known for his Christological articulation. It was he who expressed Orthodox Christology clearly. As Leban Joseph remarks in court, "Christology of Severus was absolutely correct and complete," unquote. The core of his Christology is the real union of two natures in Christ, but that the distinction of divinity and the humanity is continued within the unity without separation. His contribution to the development of Syriac liturgical music is worth mentioning here. In the Huthomo, his name is mentioned as the one who nourished the Church with music. During his time, Syriac music reached its zenith and it was made systematic as well. He composed a lot of liturgical hymns. He used him as a method of theological articulations, as more of him did. Most of his hymns are the source of theology in the form of faith articulations and biblical expositions. The liturgical hymn called Maniso, used in our Holy Kurbana, is the elucidation of his Christology. The Syriac word Maniso means song of praise. This Maniso is basically glorification of our Lord Jesus along with the Holy Trinity. The Maniso is used in the beginning of Holy Kurbana as a part of the first procession of encircling the holy altar, which symbolizes the incarnation of our Lord. So this Maniso is an incarnational song. I would like to make brief reflection on the various theological suppositions found in the Maniso. Intercession of Saint Mary and saints. In the beginning of the Maniso, he seeks intercession to the Mary and the saints while glorifying our Lord. He glorifies the Lord with company of witnessing community of the past. This prayer is a proof of the liturgical practice of having intercession of saints and Saint Mary in the early Church. More Severus is here following the existing patristic tradition. The hymn points to the corporate nature of worship in our Church. Worship in the Church is not just the activity of the present generation, but it is a corporate expression of the Church. It includes the departed believers of the past as well. Through the act of worship, the earth and heaven are united. In this prayer, his vision of the Church is also revealed here. The Church as a witnessing community also include those who already witnessed our Lord in the past. In the letter of Hebrew, chapter 12, verse 1, St. Paul mentions the great clouds of witness. Therefore, the Church is understood as a community of both the living and the dead. In the writing of Severus, the importance of saints is viewed in three ways. One, they are the model of imitation. Two, they are the source of knowledge of God and Christian doctrines. And three, They are helpers and agent of salvation for human being. According to Severius, Christ is a primary model of imitation and the saints are the secondary model of imitation. God sent saints to us so that we could imitate them for reaching perfection. Severius called the saints as the pillars of perfection. The saints also help us to come to salvation. Therefore, they are also agents of salvation. According to Severius, the saints have social significance because they are a corrective force of the evils in society. Severius also calls the holy saints as the spiritual healers of sinners. It is interesting to note that salvation is understood in Syriac tradition as healing. Holy people are the source of extraordinary powers because of their holiness. Thus, Maniso explores the liturgical practice of the intercession of saints in our church. The rest of prayers in the Maniso are the explanation about Jesus Christ, whom he glorifies. This explanation exhibits his Christology. Now let's examine some of the features of Christ highlighted in the Maniso. He uses three Christological titles for Christ in the hymn. The only begotten Son. He uses the Syriac word Ihidoyo for the only begotten Son. Christ is understood as the only begotten Son and the Word of Heavenly Father. The only begotten Son of God incarnate on the earth. The title only begotten Son shows the pre-existence of Christ. Jesus Christ is consubstantial with the Father and pre-existent with the Father. Severius explains that God the Father is eternal begetter of Christ and Son is the hypostatic word. The second title used for Christ is Logos. Like other patristic thinkers, Severius also understands Son in the framework of Logos theology. The term also represents the pre-existence of Christ. It reflects the Johannine Christology. Third, immortal. This title shows that God is by nature immortal and not susceptible to death. The next part of the Maniso deals with the notion of salvation. According to Severius, Jesus, the great high priest, is the first cause of our salvation. The very purpose of incarnation is to provide life and salvation to all people. He affirms oneness of salvation and it is open to all people. It means to all who live in the world. He perceives salvation as holistic, integral and universal. Thus, he emphasized on the unity of salvation offered to all people irrespective of differences. He uses the Syriac term kule genso dabinainosho, meaning all generations. The wider understanding of Christian salvation will enable us to build an inclusive community today. It will widen the horizon of Christian mission. The ultimate aim of Christian mission is to bring salvation to all people, irrespective of race, gender, and national differences. Severius did not confine salvation to human alone, but include the physical world as well. In his thought, salvation is meant for all creation. To him, salvation is the restoration of all creation to its original glory, which was lost. Salvation is also the renewing of the physical aspect of creation. Here, Severius took the physical world of existence seriously. In the letter of St. Paul to the Romans, chapter 8, verse 19, Paul also perceives salvation as meant for all creation. He said that all creation is groaning for the revelation of Christ. Severus' understanding of salvation will help us to take the material world which we have been living in seriously. He has a positive attitude towards the physical world. This gives new direction to our Christian mission. Our mission should include transforming this world and restructuring the contemporary society in conformity with the kingdom values. This positive attitude toward the physical world has ecological significance also. He further interprets the salvific action of Christ in different ways. The following terms are employed for explaining salvation. First, salvation as a new creation. The purpose of incarnation is to provide newness to the creation. In line with Pauline understanding of Christ Adam typology, Severus also called Jesus as the second Adam. Through the act of incarnation, Jesus removed the sin of the first Adam. Christ as a second Adam has brought newness to the creation. Salvation also includes the renewal of the human body. Due to the Adamic sin, human body underwent punishment. So the renewal of body is indispensable. Secondly, salvation is the restoration of the image of God in us. The sin of Adam has brought corruption to us. Restoration is providing incorruptibility to our nature. Thirdly, salvation is also rewriting the law in human heart. This understanding is peculiar to Severus. Adam's sin is interpreted as a violation of the divine law. Adam failed to keep the divine law in Garden of Eden. Here, sin is perceived as the failure of keeping the divine law. So, Jesus is the lawgiver to human being. Through the act of incarnation of Christ, spiritual laws are fully revealed. According to him, baptism is the mark of writing spiritual law in human hearts. Severus also considers that salvation is possible with the grace of God. As in tune with Pauline thought, he sees salvation as a gift of God. Next part of the prayer of Paniso deals with the incarnation. He used the Syriac word Edgasha, which means put on body. He has a positive outlook towards the body. Image of God represents both body and soul together as a single nature. In court, man has been made in the image of God himself, of soul and body without confusion, a single prosopon, a single hypostasis, a single nature. Thus he sees human being as an integral, so one has to respect the body. The next session of the prayer of Paniso gives due importance to the Virgin Mary. Severus emphasized the role of Mary in the salvation economy. Mary stands in relation to Christology. Mary is called Mother of God, Theotokos. The Syriac word used here, Yoldas Aloho. He describes Mary as a saint, glorious and holy. Mary, the Mother of God, brought Christ to the world. He rejected Nestorian position that Mary did not give birth to the Godhead. Severus remarks in court, because the doctors of church confess in unison that God the Word was conceived in her womb by the Virgin Theotokos and that he was united hypostatically with the flesh, unquote. The union of divine and human incarnate took place in Mary. This Paniso also calls our attention to the importance of Mary in the incarnation process. The next part of the prayer in the Manisa explains the divine human union in Christ. Severus developed the Christology against Calcedonian formula of in two natures. Severus developed his Christology based on Cyril of Alexandria. Without any change of divinity, the humanity took incarnation in Jesus Christ according to him. He used the Syriac word dloshukhlofo, meaning without difference. This word shows how the distinction of hypostasis existed without separation in the incarnated Christ. He emphasized the hypostatic union in the divinity and humanity in Christ. He stressed the dual consubstantiality of the incarnate Christ, that is to say, Son is the same substance with the Father and the same substance with human. In the incarnate Word, divine and human are united indivisibly. This union did not affect its integrity of both natures, but difference and distinction of natures is continued in the union. This difference is maintained in natural characteristics of nature. Thus, union preserved the difference within it without contradiction. God did not change in the process of incarnation. He remained what he was. According to him, human nature also was not passive, but human nature is bestowed with will, reason in the incarnate Christ. Thus, the union was without confusion and division. The properties and faculties of each nature are preserved distinctively. Thus, one Christ without confusion, one person, one hypostasis, one nature belong to the incarnated Word. This is hypostatic union. The next part of the prayer of Manisa focused on the death of Christ. Jesus died on the cross on behalf of us and trampled our death by taking our punishment in his body. He was crucified for us. The death of Christ is vicarious. This explanation echoes the Pauline understanding. The Manisa ends with the Trinitarian glorification. Severus followed the Trinitarian theology of the patristic tradition. Jesus shared the same substance with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Christ is the hypostatic union with the Father and the Holy Spirit. He explained the Trinitarian relationship as follows. The Father is the root of the Trinity. So the Father is the origin of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Father is eternal begetter of Son, and it is from the Father that the Holy Spirit proceeds. He sees the Son as the living mind of the Father. According to him, Father is unapproachable light and invisible. It is the Son who reveals the Father through incarnation. Therefore, Christ is the door to the knowledge of God. Son is both the revealer and object of knowledge of God. He leads us to the Father. The worship is focused on the Trinity, that is to say, we are glorifying the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit together. Thus, the object of worship is to praise the mystery of the Trinity. He rejects radical Christocentrism. Thus, the Manisa of Mor Severius is an expression of our faith. This song is filled with theological articulation. In our tradition, liturgy is a source of theology. This hymn throws light into the Christology of the early church. When we sing the hymn, we confess our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and we proclaim to the world who Christ is for us. Therefore, this Manisa is a creedal affirmation of the church. Thank you. May God bless all of you.